Testing 1, 2, 3.
Good afternoon, everyone. This is Alfredo speaking, and welcome to our coronavirus task force on racial disparities group and conversation. I'm just going to take a moment to introduce our panelists. Please do know they did not want me to do this, but I'm going to do it anyways. We shortened the bio by about 90%, but we do want you to get to know who they are first, and then they'll have a discussion, and we'll have time for Q&A as well. So I'll start with Dr. Robert Orellana on my far left, and he is a senior epidemiologist with the CDC Foundation supporting Michigan Department of Health and Human Services. He was assigned to MDHHS as part of the COVID-19 response team in June of 2020. In his role, he has provided technical assistance to MDHHS on epidemiology and laboratory science in responding to COVID-19, including improving data quality, expanding surveillance methods, and addressing disparities, particularly among minority groups. His work with MDHHS has expanded with providing epidemiologic assistance in response to other outbreaks and public threats, including Mpox, RSV, and influenza. Previously, Dr. Orellana has worked in outbreak response, hospital infection control, molecular and cellular biology, and Global Infectious Disease Epidemiology. I love that word, I can't pronounce it. But I'm really good with the word operationalizing, and I'm sure that some of you can't pronounce it, so we're even. Okay, we have Jametta Lilly right next to the doctor. Jametta Lilly is an innovative socialpreneur and change agent that has served as a CEO, administrator, and consultant with government, private, nonprofit agencies, foundations, and the private sector. Jametta is a consummate advocate for equitable policies, programs, and practices that address structural racism and positively impact vulnerable children, families, and communities in the United States and internationally. At Detroit Parent Network since May 2018, Jametta is pivoting a 20-year-old organization into an intentional cradle to career multi-generational institutions that is data-informed and driven by DPN's mission and best practices in the field. And right next to Jametta, we have Thomas Stallworth, currently serves as senior advisor for legislative and external affairs to Michigan's Governors Gretchen Whitmer, and is president of the Stallworth Consulting Group, LLC, a strategic government relations and systems change management firm. His role includes acting as the former director of Michigan's Coronavirus Racial Disparities Task Force, where he led the effort in support of Lieutenant Governor Gilbert's to respond to the pandemic and address racial equity gaps in health, education, and economic opportunity. Right next to Mr. Stallworth, we have Brenda Jegede. Brenda is passionate about advancing policy programs and services to improve health outcomes for racial and ethnic residents in Michigan. Brenda has worked in a variety of positions focused on health equity, maternal and child health, HIV STD services, and injury prevention with the Michigan Department of Health and Human Services for close to 18 years. Currently, Brenda leads the Office of Equity and Minority Health within the Office of Race, Equity, Diversity, and Inclusion at MDHHS. She is responsible for administration of the statewide minority health programs, including development of policies, procedures, and standards, assessment of trends and issues. Sorry. And coordination of activities with local, state, regional, and federal government agencies. Brenda led the Coronavirus Task Force on Racial Disparities Strategic Testing Infrastructure Work Group. And last but not least, right here next to me is Yesenia Murillo, is an equity training manager at the Michigan Department of Health and Human Services, Office of Ready Equity and Minority Health. As an equity, inclusion, belonging, and cultural competency subject matter expert with 14 years of experience, she leads the departmental strategy and resources, including curricula, tools, plans, technical assistance, and coaching. She serves as the lead and principal author of the MDHHS Equity Impact Assessment Process, an effort aligned with the Michigan Coronavirus Disparities Task Force for addressing racism as a public health crisis. She is a leadership member of the Diversity, Equity, and Inclusion Council and the Michigan Committee of Practice and Developmental Disability. And Yesenia will also be our moderator for today. So please welcome our amazing panel and welcome to the discussion.
All right, so we have to push the button, and I'm gonna try to do my best. If I ever forget, you can laugh it out, it's okay. All right, welcome everyone to this panel discussion. Today I have the pleasure of sharing space with people that I've known for years, so if it is okay with everyone, I will call you by your first name, and we can have dialogue together. So, as we know, disparities exist across all sectors. However, this summit is shining light on the disparities and the impact, particularly of discrimination on health. So, as such, during the pandemic, we learned and gained strategies to mitigate disparities health disparities in marginalized communities. Efforts from the Michigan Racial Disparities Task Force were recognized at a national level as our state led the way in multiple playing fields, including reducing implicit bias in testing and treatment, as well as declaring racism a public health crisis. We hope that by way of this panel, sharing learned lessons and their lived experience, you can all take away practices to be replicated. We hope that you're empowered to continue your advocacy within your networks and workplaces. So let's continue. I feel like this is a continuation of the conversation that Tommy was leading in the opening plenary this morning. Just to set the stage, Tommy started talking about how the Racial Disparities Task Force was formed and the charge of the task force. So recognizing that people's health is directly impacted by discrimination and systemic racism, Tommy highlighted that it was really a result of us seeing stark disparities really impacting and burdening people of color, racial and ethnic minorities. I want to give you an opportunity, Tommy, to expand on that. And the question would be, what would you say generated momentum from a state government perspective to create a task force charged with addressing racial and ethnic disparities during the pandemic?
Thanks, Yesenia. There were a number of factors. I think it's probably important to note that having Gretchen Whitmer as governor, a governor who was brave enough to acknowledge that there was a difference in how the pandemic was affecting various communities was an important factor. And as I mentioned earlier, we have been living in a time of 40 years where we've not had the kind of leadership in Michigan focused on equity or using an equity lens as they examined problems. And so I think her leadership and her courage in stepping forward to both acknowledge that black folks were dying at far greater rates than their counterparts was a major, major step. Secondly, and we've got Dr. Orellana here. You know, when we started in the pandemic, we didn't really have a way to track the numbers. How many people were dying, what their races and sexes were, where they lived, where we were experiencing surges, or even where improvements were occurring. And so we had to build the infrastructure and the metrics that helped us track those things. Dr. Orellana was critical in that process because looking at the numbers every week helped us build momentum. It kept us focused on the disparity that exists in stark black and white numbers. And so the tragedy of it all was right in front of our face on a weekly basis. And that reinforced our commitment to do something. And then lastly, we had just a great group of diverse community stakeholders working on that task force and supporting the task force effort. And their commitment to initially meet on a weekly basis to address the issue, I think, again, was largely a huge contributor to building momentum and closing the disparities that existed early in the pandemic.
Thank you, Tommy, for highlighting the importance of having a bold and brave state government leadership, right, in putting some accountability and action to the horrendous reality that we were facing.
You see, one thing I forgot to mention is that, and as this group, as we undertake any effort to address disparities or discrimination or racism, being clear about, you know, how you measure success is important. And the group that came together, that task force committed itself to saving lives and extending life. And so everything we did was measured against that objective. And if what we were talking about didn't have an impact on that objective, we quickly dismissed it and move to something that was going to have an impact. So I just wanted to mention that. I'm sorry.
No, and Tommy's very humble. It was thanks to state leadership, partners, and community members, but also thanks to you for leading that charge, Tommy, and spearheading us in the right direction. So with that, talking a little bit more about the makeup of the task force and thinking about the motto, nothing about us without us in disability justice, the task force was formed very strategically. Tommy just alluded to that fact. The makeup included people from state government, partners across sectors, and community members to co-create those decisions and solutions that would help us address the pandemic. And so for that particular context, how did this level of collaboration contribute to the overall success of the task force? And if I can start, perhaps Tommy, you can continue just to allude a little bit, and then I would like to go next to Jametta.
Sure. Again, you can't solve systemic problems without representation from those who are impacted. And so I think the governor did a nice job of appointing people who were good stewards and good representatives of their communities and their professions. And so we had those diverse voices at the table. And that piece was critical to understanding, you know, how best to deploy resources, what strategies were going to be most effective, and equally important is the people who were there were committed. I mean, they showed up, as I mentioned earlier, every Friday, 3 to 5, that was a test of commitment, and they were there. Good weather, bad weather, didn't matter. They were there, and so their commitment was huge. But I think for this group, again, the continuity of the work was very important, and it built camaraderie and amongst the members. I think it's probably, you asked earlier about learnings. It's also important to note that everybody that was appointed didn't show up. And you guys probably experienced that in your organizing activity. Sometimes folks you are counting on, they just don't come to the meetings. They don't come to weigh in on the problem like you would hope that they would. But despite that, our team, the team that did show up, did the work, and we were okay with that, because if you weren't committed, you didn't need to be there. And those that were doing enough of the work to help us move the ball.
Thank you, and I really just want to underline how much of a profound time these last 3 years have been. And it's been a profound blessing, I will say, for myself to been able to be at the table with solution builders, with people who had the spirit of cooperation first, and skills, and an understanding of the reality of structural racism. And of what we certainly all learned very quickly, for those who didn't really understand the nature of racism, COVID just stripped away any delusions that we don't have systemic racism in this country. I think the other thing that occurred, and we heard it so much in what Tommy just shared, is that leadership matters. Who is at the table? And so in addition to, obviously, Governor Whitmer, we also had the benefit of our lieutenant governor, who in fact was serving as the chair and who consistently showed up and engaged us in such a way to say, how do we all individually and collectively make a difference? So one of the things that was really particularly joyful for me, serving as the CEO of the Detroit Parent Network, a small but mighty community-based organization, enabled me to bring some 30 years both in public health and mental health, to bring that lens, and the lens of what do community folks need to hear. So here was a major dilemma. The reality was, in the early stages of COVID, we all know this, the community was, well, who do I believe? Do I believe TikTok? Do I believe my neighbors? Do I believe people that I see on TV who do not look like me, but are telling me this is how I should act and respond to? And so we learned very early, and certainly in the Detroit area, we pulled together some 30 organizations, came together to create the COVID-313 Community Coalition that we did every week. So in addition to having the privilege of being part of the awesome work of the task force, gave us a local opportunity where we engaged with Detroit Public TV, 400,000 people to message as trusted messengers in this work. So leadership matters. Having a diversity of voices, multi-sectors, health leaders, epidemiologists, people who understand the politics coming together and to be zeroing in on how do we bring our best, our A game, to the table consistently, but also so important is to have trusted messengers that look like the community, who the community understands and are engaged with them, because that's the infrastructure we also need to mitigate anything else, certainly in the future.
Thank you so much, Jametta. You just said a couple things that were very intriguing, and I wanted to highlight that just as you stated, this is not news to us, right? Systemic racism has been in place and has been operating very intentional historically. And it was the pandemic that, as you put it, it just shredded all kinds of delusions that, you know, we justify. Sometimes we say, well, is it really systemic racism? Yes, systemic racism is embedded in any kind of life outcome. So thank you for saying that. And I like the term trusted messengers and the importance that you're highlighting. Without trusted messengers, especially coming from state government, we are not going to get to the root causes of strategizing together of the problems and the solution. We have to really acknowledge and accept the history of oppression that we've endured in communities, especially in marginalized communities, communities of color. And so trust in messengers, some people call them cultural brokers, cultural liaisons, they're critical to the work that the task force did, but also the work of equity in general. So one more question regarding just the task force in general. And I did not say this, but obviously you understand now that these are standing members of the task force and they're leaders. I have the pleasure of having two leaders of two separate work groups. There were five work groups in total, and Brenda and Jametta led two of them. And so in this collaborative effort, thinking about the charge of the work groups was one of advice, of putting together recommendations to address health disparities, recommendations for action, right? And I think Tommy, tangible, measurable, right? This is Tommy's voice all the time. And so when you think about the way that the task force prioritized these dedicated work groups and what you did, what would you say where you're learning lessons from that process? Brenda, if I can start with you as the leader of strategic infrastructure.
Thank you. So many of the lessons learned, we've kind of, you know, spoke to them, but what really comes to mind is two main things. We really allowed data to inform what we were doing, and listening to the community. If those were two things that, you know, I could highlight, is those two things. And as you said, you know, our charge was setting up an infrastructure to make sure we got testing to those that were experiencing those disparate, you know, outcomes. So we were trying to reach African Americans. You know, we were trying to reach racial and ethnic populations, other populations that have been marginalized. So one of the things that has been mentioned is we had to pull together that diverse group of organizations, many of them who were already out there answering the call. They were already getting, you know, people coming to them asking for how to get resources, how to overcome some of the challenges. So they were the people on the ground. So we had the variety that we talked about. We had community-based organizations. We had some private industries. We had CVS at the table. We had our local health departments, of course. We also had, you know, our representatives who wanted to make sure there were, you know, resources in their district and their offices were there, and then also people at the state level. So we had that diverse group of people at the table to help to direct what it is that we were doing. And I think about some of our main recommendations, and one was really knowing how to advocate when we know there's scarce resources, limited resources. So for example, I think sometimes we forget what it was like just a couple years ago, but when we first had the testing resources, they were not available to everybody. Right. You know, everybody couldn't get tested. And there was a time where you had to be symptomatic in order to get tested, and sometimes you had to have, you know, insurance to get tested. So I think about one of our first recommendations was to expand that testing criteria, especially in communities of color. When you had someone that tested positive, we should allow everyone in that home to receive a test. You know, we knew that just even crowding or spacing in the home, we had intergenerational, you know, people living in the homes. It was a common sense thing to do, and it would make an impact. So that was one. Also, in terms of data-driven, I think about how much we heard about social vulnerability index. You know, everybody learned SVI, and what was SVI? But CDC had been looking at what was happening to our communities for a long time to see whether or not our communities could rebound from something like a disaster. So they were looking at where do you have people who might be of lower income, people who have higher levels of unemployment, who may not have transportation access. So that data was there, and that's what led us to how we could make some decisions, how we set up our 22 neighborhood testing sites. So when you speak to systemic racism, all those things that was impacting the income, unemployment, lack of transportation, those were all things that had been a result of that systemic racism that we should have been looking at. So those were some of the lessons learned. Also the trusted messengers, the way that the testing and coordination teams set out to find trusted messengers, someone who could fill the gap. It was by going to those places where the community was already going. We say this, we know this, and most of those 22 sites, 18 of them was with churches, trusted, you know, entities within the community. So we were setting up those type of services. And then I would just say lastly, culture competency. You know, one of the things we talk about a lot in terms of access to services is why people are not accessing services. And we have a lot of reasons, you know, why, from discrimination to racism to implicit bias. But not showing up in a space where people are culturally competent, you know, also discourages people from services. So we were very intentional about the people that we were using to help bring some of the services to the churches, actually training them. Yesenia Murillo and Mariah Martin trained them in terms of being able to understand the culture of the community, and then also looking at first source hiring. So when they had positions that was open, we want you to go to the church and talk to church about who in the community has those resources. So really building that cultural type of atmosphere that we know is positive in terms of health outcomes. So those are a few of the lessons learned that we take with us. And I would say many of those lessons learned, the community already knew them.
Yeah, I'm happy to add that. I just want to piggyback on one of the things we talked about, taking it to the community. Health in all things. I think that was something that no matter where you were, in a private sector, if you're in environmental studies, we all began to realize health has to be in all things, and therefore it requires everyone to be involved in it. So one of the issues, one of the committees that I had the opportunity to be a part of was our telehealth. And we know how incredibly important that was, but what happened during COVID that we knew about? Well, we've already known for 20 years we had a digital divide in this country. And so suddenly now we have grandma, we have uncle, we have dads. All of us are all trying to access broadband, but it's insufficient. Many of us are trying to access using devices that we really don't know how to operate. Our kids are trying to do this. And so if we were having these dilemmas in our home and in education, certainly that was an issue for people to get care. So there was a telehealth work group, and a couple things that we learned very early in this process. One was that what we already knew was that we had this digital divide, but we had an ally in this, which is kind of another one of our secret sauce, is that the lieutenant governor himself happens to come from a technology background. So a couple of things emerged out of this group. One, we discovered as we were talking about telehealth, there was an automatic assumption that the problem was going to be is that your grandmother or you as a consumer would not know how to use telehealth to access services. But what we began to talk about, and we did this through some anecdotal, but then began to spread it around the state, was we began to find out that was providers were also uncomfortable, particularly using Zoom, Microsoft Teams, et cetera. So there was actual bias on the part of providers to engage the community in that way. But in many other cases, we found that telehealth actually zoomed up in terms of utilization. The Detroit Wayne County network found out that there was over a 200% jump in telehealth in the first couple of months of COVID because people were making phone calls. But the question was, then we began to say, well, are there standards of care? Should we in fact be allowing people who may have a diabetes issue or may have some other kind of pressing health only get care through a telephone call or only get care through Zoom? So there was a need then to begin to bring together the regulatory entities working with Medicaid, with Medicare, and we ran into the other issue, and Dr. O, you know this well. We didn't have data that really showed us what are the standards that are out there, how many of the providers have the infrastructure and the training themselves to be able to help people in the community. So what grew out of the telehealth work group was, one, we need to increase broadband. Check, that's happening in the state of Michigan. Two, we need to create access to the devices that are appropriate. Check, we saw wonderful things like the Let's Connect issue that happened in the Detroit Wayne area and in rural communities as well as in indigenous communities, people getting access to the devices. And then thirdly, train in on how actually to use the device. And that training is something that not only went out to everyday consumers, but also the recommendation is that health providers themselves need to be trained on how to use these tools and then how to engage people in this thing called Zoom, which is actually a whole new modality when we start thinking about health and wellness. The last thing I'd like to add, what I would say is another lesson learned. So for those who know me know that, okay, I was in telehealth, but I was also very engaged with our primary care work group, where we know that we need to have everybody with access to a quality medical home. And what we're proud to say is, again, most of the recommendations that emerged, which were things like we need to have a coordinated care system that's focused on the individual so no matter where you go, that you can access quality coordinated care, is something that emerged from that group, reinforcing what many people have always been saying, but the data is there. So with both of the work groups, what we saw were challenges. There was a challenge of getting data. There was a challenge of getting information quickly, but in spite of it, and always we had Tommy saying to us, okay, so now what? What are you doing? What's the next thing? So that kind of drive kept us focused on, are we making a difference? And then having the opportunity to succinctly identify recommendations, and those recommendations didn't just fall onto the floor. They didn't just go onto a shelf, and that's what is exciting in this work, is to let people know those recommendations went to an administration that in turn turned towards its governmental entities, legislators turned to each other and then said, how do we make sure we build this into policy? How do we build this into not only policy and practice, but let's build it into the funding mechanisms so that we can do this slow but necessary walk towards equity and improving our health.
Yeah, that's beautiful. It reminds me of like talking the talk and walking the walk. We were really trying to, and Tommy has always been an advocate of, give me the recommendation and I will find the numbers and the dollars. But it had to be a good one though. It had to be good.
You're saying it nicer than he used to say sometimes.
I was joking inside of my head. I love it when my manager, Brenda, rolls her R's. Yesenia Murillo, I love that. Thank you so much. That talks about cultural competency. And cultural competency reminds me of both work groups that you represent, but I was just thinking, these are superwomen. They were both in two different work groups, now that I think about it. You were also in Century and Equity. One thing that we didn't address necessarily was access to telehealth. Jametta talked about the digital divide. I would like to just highlight briefly language access, right? Continuing to ensure that language is appropriate to our residents, our neighbors, our communities. I remember also a huge advocacy around mask wearing when it talked about language access, because people who are hard of hearing, deaf, or are deaf-blind did not have the capability of reading the lips when we wore our masks. And that was the beginning of the pandemic, right? Like, mask wearing for everyone. Well, we are missing this population of people that cannot read our lips. And so there was a lot of effort as well around language access and setting up those infrastructures and those mechanisms for everyone to have access to information and to be able to exchange with us. So with that, let's transition over to interventions. Jametta was already hinting at that, so I think it's a smooth transition. Talking about those recommendations that we've alluded to, how did the Racial Disparities Task Force pioneer responses to COVID-19? And what were some of the specific interventions that the task force led? And just to switch it up from a work group perspective, we'll have Robert talk about this one from a data perspective.
Certainly, thank you, Yesenia. And certainly I will open up to my colleagues here on the panel to provide some input as well. But I think it's important to remember, you know, at the time that the task force was initially established, there was so much we didn't know. We didn't know about COVID, we didn't know about the COVID response, and we didn't know what we needed to do. So I think the establishment, the executive order that established the task force in itself was a great pioneering response, something that was recognized nationally multiple times and was replicated in other states as well as at the federal level. I know there were several members of our task force that were served as advisors to the White House as they established their own racial disparities task force. So that in and of itself, I think, was an excellent pioneering response. Some of the other specifics, when we talk about the work groups that were just mentioned, we had, at the time of the establishment of the task force, really focused on several key areas that we wanted to address in the pandemic. One of those was increasing transparency to data collection and reporting. I will expand on that in a little bit. But also reducing barriers to healthcare access. I know that Brenda mentioned previously about the neighborhood testing sites. We also provided mobile health clinics. And all of these were to reach people who may not have traditional access to urgent care, emergency departments, and testing sites that maybe might be accessible in some areas of the state, but not in others. I think that was an excellent pioneering response. It's something that we certainly had been asked from several of our partners at the national level on how to replicate that in other states and in other areas. Jametta talked about the telehealth. Certainly that relates to reducing bias and testing and treatment. We also established, I don't know if it was mentioned yet here today, having all medical providers undergo implicit bias training to allow for that cultural competence. I think that was an excellent response, and certainly I'm sure I wasn't there with boots on the ground, but for Brenda and Yesenia and others who were more boots on the ground when you were training your staff, I'm sure that helped. And then to address the structural racism, the structural barriers that many individuals experience, making testing free, making it not having limitations on testing that Brenda talked about. Those were major, major hurdles because we didn't know who to treat, how to treat them if we didn't know who was sick. And Brenda expanded on that a little bit ago. So what I mentioned was increasing transparency of reporting of data both by race and ethnicity. This was a huge undertaking early on. If you're thinking that, okay, it's just as simple as just getting the information to the epidemiologist, it's much more complicated than that. Jametta mentioned one thing about trusted messengers, and that was really important. When folks were getting tested, they weren't sure what was being taken from them. They had hesitancies. Then why are all these additional questions being asked of me? Why does someone need to know my race and ethnicity, where I live? What do I do? It was all for having trusted messengers. They're saying, we're going to use this information so that we can provide the resources where they're most needed. So having that opportunity to convey the importance of collecting those data and having the individual realize that they, by providing that data, was helping our response was extremely important. The next was having the providers to make sure that they were collecting the data and collecting it in systems that would be able to communicate with other systems. So that's really two points in one. So having systems that would, if I asked, you know, I'm Hispanic, but there are a lot of different Hispanics. We all identify with our strong cultural group. And so having a system that could allow for very detailed information, but also communicate with other systems, say if that information was being sent to the state health department, or at the federal level, that could communicate to still aggregate those individuals in their respective group, but then group it appropriately. And then, as I mentioned, also having the providers realize the importance of collecting that data. Oftentimes, if folks remember, early on in the pandemic and certainly during surges, there were hundreds, if not thousands, of people getting tested at single sites. And having the opportunity to take the time to collect that information and realize it's important that I collect race and ethnicity, not just the name and the address and the date of birth, was extremely important. So really requiring or making those fields required, so before they submitted that data to the state, that information was collected and in a manner that was optimized. So I know the neighborhood testing sites did a lot to make sure that those data points were collected in an anonymous way where folks didn't feel threatened, but also was collected in a quick manner. And then, as I mentioned, also having the electronic systems. Some information was collected on paper, while other information was collected through different systems, having what we would call the HL7 messaging to allow the interoperability, the exchange of the data in a bidirectional way, whether it was collected from vaccination data or testing data, that could then go into the system that would allow for ultimately that information to be reported to the state, and then we could share it with the task force and say, these are the populations, this is these are the people, this is where it's happening, and this is to who it's happening. And that way we could kind of have a more personalized response. I don't know if any of my panelists would like to add.
There is an element I'd like to add, and I think it's a historical tension between science and community. You know, just for a moment, and I think Tommy as well as Dr. O just talked about, that we were being data-driven. But we also knew in the early stages we didn't have the data. Folks in the community knew what was going on. And those of us who have been engaged in different communities, we watched certain hospitals and we knew people who were being turned away. We learned of people who were driving a bus one day and dead in 2 days. And while we couldn't necessarily have the data that got down to the block and down to that specific area, through those relationships and the partners enabled us to begin to build a qualitative story that then needed to have the support of the quantitative elements. So I think that's important for us to remember, that there are different levels by which we can engage communities to build the story and build the infrastructure that we want to identify. The other thing I just want to say really quickly about data is that we were using the data not only to make sure people got the vaccines, but one of the things certainly with Detroit Parent Network, we were so blessed to work with Wayne Health, specifically around the mobile units. We trained up, recruited, and coached parents to become family advocates who stood in the lines with the medical folks and walked up to people and said, so what else can I help you with? So we were connecting people to food, to basic needs. If we saw you with a three-year-old, then we're gonna ask the question, what about your child care? So that is a more holistic way of how can we begin to engage communities, not only in terms of their health, but their overall well-being. And that's one of the things that the mobile units have done, and through community health workers and that kind of engagement, we've been able to see increase, and that was one of the infrastructure pieces that we didn't have enough of, that I think has been really phenomenal to see grow with our health departments and also other community providers.
I just wanted to add, because you're making me remember things, Jametta is one of my team members, but Jametta, because yes, we were looking at all that data when we were trying to establish the neighborhood testing sites. Our epidemiologist was doing a fabulous job looking at SVI, but also looking at where were the chronic diseases, because we know that there were more, you know, extreme impact that could happen with someone who got COVID, looking at where the cases were, et cetera. So we had census tracts. We knew where we wanted to go based on those needs. But it was not until we spoke with the community for them to validate and say yes. It could even be, okay, you said you wanted to be here in Flint, but you really should be on this side of the street in Flint, and it should be with this organization. It was that type of guidance that helped us to go where we knew the community would be comfortable, where they were used to go being. I think about Maureen Taylor from Welfare Rights, you know, similar to the parent network, would say, no, this is what you need to know, and this is where you should go, and we know what's happening right now. You got the data that you collected, but we can tell you what happened yesterday and last week, and we had to take that into consideration to really build our strategy. So it wasn't just the data. It was that community telling us what to do with the data that really led us to some success.
Brenda, would you mind, and Tommy, I'll come back to you, would you mind expanding on Robert's comment on like the reduction of barriers for testing and vaccination? Would you mind just talking a little bit about what that looked like?
Yes, so our work group did an excellent job bringing to us just the things that people were experiencing every day. So in addition, for instance, I remember we right away talked about we cannot require everyone to have a government-issued ID to receive services. You are already blocking out a lot of, you know, the community, one, who don't have state IDs or government-issued IDs for a variety of reasons, or two, those who may be undocumented in our community saying we're not coming, you know, to receive those services that we need. So very clearly hearing about those type of barriers and putting out the message that, one, you don't need ID for services. Two, it was phenomenal that you could receive the services and not at a cost. You know, if you need the service, you're gonna come and get the service. Yes, if you have insurance, we would like to collect that insurance. And one of the things I wanted to mention about, for instance, the mobile health units, which our lieutenant governor, you know, found out about a wonderful pilot that Ford Motor Company and Wayne State University and Access was doing, and really wanted to get the service to people where they were. And they had so many ways that they could provide services. People could drive up to the services, they could take the services to a business and help them, you know, test their employees there. They could go to schools to help do testing there. They could even go to reach those that were homebound. So there was all the ways that they could go to the community to provide the service. But they were also collecting a lot of data, and because they were connecting with the community did give them race and ethnicity data. They did tell them about all the other demographics because they were building trust with the community. So I think it was just a great demonstration of having your parents there, you know, from Detroit Parent Network connecting people to services and them understanding why we were asking for that data and how it was gonna benefit them. So those are some of the types of barriers we address. We also very intentionally, you know, talked about access services for those with disabilities. We really connected a lot with various organizations around deaf, blind, hard of hearing, intellectual, developmental disabilities, and really talked about what it looked like to provide those services and why it was important for those different populations in terms of how we're prepared to receive someone, for instance, with a developmental disability within our areas. So we connected many times the staff that were at the neighborhood testing sites with organizations. We were trying to make that connections with those organizations that lead efforts around disability so that they could receive the training and information that they needed to provide those services. So those are some, and we talked a lot about just when we were asking race and ethnicity data, we pushed a lot about how we were asking for that data. And now we're doing it at a state level and a national level, for instance, where when we ask for race and ethnicity, we're not asking two questions, we're asking one combined question: what is your race or ethnicity? You don't have to say, I am white, and then have to look and say, well, are you Hispanic? You know, so you can definitely be able to say, I'm Hispanic and not choose that I'm white. So we were hearing from the community that those things were barriers for them, and we were doing our best to address those types of barriers.
Thanks, Brenda. And Tommy?
Yeah, thanks. Thanks, Yesenia. A couple things I just want to add as takeaways from the work groups that I think may be helpful to those of you who are organizing and trying to address issues of discrimination or racial disparities. Our task force was charged with not only reducing the immediate impacts of the pandemic, but trying to figure out what drove those disparities and what we could do to avoid a similar experience in the future. And one of the discoveries that came out of the work group's work was that, and maybe we should have known this all along, but based on you know, how our society is constructed, you know, people of color and black folks in particular were concentrated in vocational and professions and professional jobs that gave them more exposure to the virus. So concentrated as bus drivers, concentrated as police officers, concentrated in public-facing, public-interacting jobs. They aren't the kind of jobs you can work from home to do. You have to go to work. And as such, they had far greater exposure to infection and the virus. And thus, accordingly, you saw a much larger spread throughout those communities. Secondly, obviously, based on disparities in poverty rates, homes are smaller. Mm-hmm. More people living in the home. So when a family member is infected, they can't isolate or quarantine because there's nowhere to go to do that. And so, you know, disease or infection spreads throughout the household and amongst family members, again, ultimately leading to the tragic effects we had of more deaths. And then, of course, outdated congregate settings or structures like schools. Schools in urban communities are old, super old, with old and outdated HVAC systems. And so again, as a child goes to school in a daycare setting or to K-12 public school and is infected, the air that they are breathing is then travels and is shared amongst all the other students who then also now are infected and who again take that infection home and spread it amongst their family members. And so, you know, these are demographic conditions or circumstances that we face within communities of color that impact how we address health care, how we address infection rates, how we address any other number of social determinants of health. I probably need to also mention that one of my takeaways, and I learned a lot, guys. I really learned so much. Not just about, you know, disease and health care, but also just about the demographics and the diversity of the people in our state. And so, for example, one of the things we encountered was, you know, the needs of our agricultural migrant workers who travel here to work during the growth season. They live in kind of dormitories, which again makes them more susceptible to the spread of infection. They're very income insecure, and so they're not gonna take off work to go to the doctor or go to the hospital. They need to work every day. And so that kind of led us to a conclusion that we needed portable health services, that we needed to be able to take those services to them. Not only did we have to do that, we had to put some pressure on their employers to allow them the time to take advantage of those services. And just the special needs of that population really opened my eyes to the diversity of need in the state. And again, I point this out to you because I think hopefully what came out of our experience are learnings that will help you in areas that you are working in and that can be replicated in your work as well. So I just wanted to share those as important takeaways from my perspective and the work that some of the work that came out of the task force.
I love that you shared those in a packaged way. So you highlighted the systemic oppression underneath the learned lessons. Is there any other commentary from anyone else on some of the systemic challenges that we faced? Tommy has done a great job at summarizing some of them.
I would add, I'm not sure if this would fall in as a systems observation because it's pervasive. And that is that through COVID to this moment now, never for many of us do we ever have seen such a level of misinformation, purposeful, deliberate misinformation to the degree that it puts people's lives and well-being in jeopardy. And yet we have an entire media system that in many cases perpetuates that. So even while our departments, our programs, our universities and others are trying to say, yes, there is an absolute reason to understand the history of science. It's not always worked to the benefit of Black and brown and indigenous people. But we also know that there are things in science, particularly when it comes to addressing disease, are something that makes the United States a place that's enviable in terms of the medications and things that we have in many other parts of the world. Somehow or the other, as a systems issue, we've got to figure out as an entire society how do we begin to combat that. Because that level of misinformation endangers us now, but also has other implications from obviously the political to our actual health. And so I think, again, trusted messengers is only a part of that. It also means that we have to be much more deliberate in our households. How are we talking to each other? What are we saying to folks when they say, I just saw this on TikTok, or I just saw this on a particular network that I may not mention right at the moment, but you know who we're talking about in terms of misinformation. I just want to say that that's one of our other takeaways, that so much of what the resistance that we experience in terms of the medical reticence about this stemmed not necessarily from fact. Much of it was about myths, busting those myths, and that's something that I think all of us who are concerned about public health and well-being have to be really focused on as we continue to move forward.
Thank you so much, Jametta. I am here just reflecting on the takeaways. Hopefully you have them written down. Robert is a great synthesizer. That was my takeaway. He just gave a wealth of information in like 3 minutes. Jametta, you just talked about other things, but before you talked about this connection between the quantitative data to the qualitative data and understanding that stories sometimes are the only source of information for certain cultures, and we cannot rob people of their reality and their lived experience, right? That qualitative information fills in the blanks of the data, the numbers. Data can be manipulated, so it's important to understand what are people really feeling about those numbers and how can we strategize around those. I just wanted to make sure that you all took that point from Jametta. And then Tommy was talking about a lot of systemic issues, and I kept thinking, perhaps because I was influenced this morning at environmental justice, space making and spatial segregation, I think, has a lot to do with everything, right? Tommy was talking about workforce. Space making is also part of workforce. Segregation also has happened across workforce, across education, across housing, across any living environment, right? And so some of those are the major systemic challenges that we were facing as we were traversing the pandemic. So from perhaps this heavy side of systems issues and problems, let's now transition to a lighter kind of area, a lighter phase, right? Results, positivity. We cannot talk about results without acknowledging that, as Tommy said this morning, there's work to be done, right? We've done amazing work, and there's still work to be done because systems are functioning very, very courageously, and systems solutions have to be continuous and long-term. So with that in mind, I'll start with perhaps, you know, when you say, okay, what do you want first, the bad or the good news? We'll start with the bad news, which is, what do we still have to do collectively? What kinds of strategies or issues are we still facing that we have to name? Because in order to understand a problem, it has to be named so that we can get to solutions, and then we'll end with those solutions and best practices before you go today. So any light on what is still something or a couple things that we need to pay attention to and we need to continue to work long-term on?
I'll start. One of the questions we ask ourselves, again, is, you know, how do we prevent this kind of catastrophe from ever happening again? And I think it's understood that the communities that we serve were marginalized, were the victims of oppression or racism, and had attributes that made them more susceptible to infection and disease as a result of living in a racist society. So, you know, high blood pressure, higher rates of heart disease, higher rates of diabetes, mm-hmm. higher rates of give me one.
You said hypertension,
asthma. Asthma, hypertension, et cetera. And so, you know, I ask a number of our, you know, professionals, our doctors, and subject matter experts, you know, what's kind of the common denominator here? If there's one or two things we could focus on that would lead to communities becoming more resilient against infection and disease, what would it be? And there were three things that came up consistently. One was access to fresh fruits and vegetables. So in other words, you know, having access to food that is healthy. Two, choosing to eat that food when it is available, rather than, you know, McDonald's or Burger King or whatever your preference is. And then thirdly, engaging in some fitness activity, walking, riding a bike, going to the gym, playing volleyball, whatever your pleasure is. But those three things are leading indicators for whether you have the resilience to resist some of the chronic diseases that make you more vulnerable to infection and disease. And so you ask, what should we be looking at going forward? And I would say, given that information, the question is, how do we build communities where there is access to fresh fruits and vegetables? How do we influence the public to make smarter choices about what they put in their body and how they actively engage in fitness activity? Those three things we should be laser focused on trying to build some momentum around if we want to prevent a similar experience, because this clearly is not going to be the last pandemic. It's going to happen again. And so we got to be focused on building resilience such that our communities can resist and combat infection when that occurs.
Yeah, I think those are excellent points. I like how you phrase that in terms of really empowering the individuals. I mean, now that's ultimately what it comes down to, is no one wants to be told what to do or how to live. To know how what to do and to know this can improve my health is certainly an approach. One thing that I would certainly add is, as you mentioned, the last point you mentioned is, we know this is not going to be our last emergency. We don't know if it's going to be another pandemic or another health emergency. We talked about potential of asthma and things like that. I'm just thinking of recent events with the fires in Canada and just how that's impacting folks who may have trouble breathing, and making sure that folks have access, that all Michiganders have access to appropriate health care, that no one is unable to access health care. But also, it kind of brings into a point of having an environment with where their health can proliferate. Having housing that is stable. We talked a little bit about HVAC and airflow. Having transportation that can get them to reliable work. Having an opportunity to know that when you're going to sleep at night, that you're safe, that you're warm. Those are certainly all things as well, I think, that can certainly impact as well.
Thank you, and I think, and Tommy, I really appreciate you lifting that up, because you're really talking about our health behaviors and that there is individual choice. And I think at the same time, those structural and systems pieces have to be battled. So it's both what we do personally, and it's also what we do at that macro level. So the reality is, we have a healthcare system. It's not very caring, and it's certainly not a system in many places. We have hospitals, we have FQHCs. We are fragmented as a system. The mechanisms by which our health is delivered is based in a model of economics that inherently does not make sure that everybody has access to healthcare. In spite of having a phenomenal leadership here in the state of Michigan, we still have thousands and thousands do not have healthcare. We still have people that will walk up to try to get care and will hit that, which we already knew, folks who are on Medicaid or in Medicare often get a different level of quality service when they go. So those kinds of issues are still there for us to battle. But I think the system's fragmentation is one of those huge monsters in the room that, like, none of us really want to go for, because that speaks to the economics of how we, in fact, do the business of trying to keep our community healthy and the well-being. But that's going to take political will, That's going to be, I think, as you mentioned, how we talk to legislators and others. And it means having hard conversations with our business community and corporations, because ultimately the question is, are we investing in the health and wellness of our community so that we can thrive? And if we're not doing that, then we're fooling ourselves, and we're not only setting ourselves up for the next pandemic, but we're going to continue to be unhealthy while we watch so many other nations in the world continue to grow, because they are making sure there is health care for all and that they're investing in the health and wellness of their community.
I absolutely agree with all of your points and love the, you know, the both and in terms of looking at both the systemic factors that impact health and the individual, you know, behaviors, knowing that there's a both and there. And I'm just thinking about, there's a role of government, you know, in this. I think in the future, there's continue to be a role of government. And I think about an example of the rapid response initiative that the task force, you know, led, where, you know, very quickly we had to get out of our regular way sometimes of doing business, where we had a good amount of money where we wanted to address what was happening in the community, had $20 million, and the way we went about needing to get that money to the community. So in the work that we've been leading around equity has really been, how do we get it to the people in the community that can do something to assist those in the community? That's what I want to push more. And I think we did a great example of that in the Rapid Response Initiative, where, you know, we didn't have time for the elaborate request for proposals that was 20 pages and you had to do this. We said, okay, 5 pages. You tell us that you've already been doing this type of work. You tell us that you have partners. You tell us that you can get this done. Tommy's looking for deliverables in, you know, 120 days. Literally, they had 3 to 4 months to spend these dollars, but they did, and they helped to put those resources for telehealth. They had, you know, hotspots for people to be able to get access. You know, they were helping people who were coming from out of the system who were incarcerated to connect to, you know, services. So I'm thinking about how we continue to get the money to the community, give them the resources, help to build their capacity. We had some of those 32 organizations that were funded. They served over 1 million people. And to Tommy's point again, the people that they served, we saw that they were impacting those that had those disparate health outcomes. So 67% were African American. I think 30-some percent was Hispanic. You know, we had those that were Asian and Arab. So we were getting to the community that we knew were having those disparate health outcomes. So my main point is pushing for those scarce resources, making the courageous decisions. We saw our leadership doing it, saying we have to focus on this population right now if we're talking about reaching equity for this population, because we know this is the population that need those resources. And then get those resources to the people in the community that can connect to the people that they're already connecting to. How can we do that? How do we continue to build their capacity to do the work? And I think that's a push and a role for government and what we need to, you know, focus on in the future.
Beautifully said. I think you have transitioned us, Brenda, to our last question in a very organic way. So we are now talking about best practices, tangible best practices that we learned through the efforts led by the Racial Disparities Task Force. And I really like this idea of giving people the access and the opportunity to lead, right? It's not necessarily that we're empowering them because they have power that has been taken away from them. It's literally giving them the chance to utilize their power and to maximize and optimize their power. So I like that a lot, what you said, Brenda. Is there any other tangible best practice that you would like to highlight, understanding that, as Robert has said, Tommy has said, and anyone here in this panel or in the task force would say, the Racial Disparities Task Force in Michigan was recognized statewide. So there are a lot of best practices that we learned. My favorite thing is that it was very adaptable. We were willing and able to make mistakes along the way and continue to push forward. There was a lot of innovative think tank and brainstorming, and that really creates unique solutions. So any other best practices that you would like to highlight?
I don't know if it was a best practice, but it was, I know one of the things that the task force members did very effectively was utilize their convening power. And so you can do this, you know, everybody in this room can do this if you have a specific problem you're focused on. And that is pulling stakeholders together to have the conversation about the problem and what needs to happen. And I can, you know, the one example of how effective that was that comes immediately to mind is while we were trying to reduce infection rates and help people stay safe, there were Black Lives Matter demonstrations going on all over the state. And so thousands of people were coming together to march and exposing themselves to the risk of infection. And then we asked task force members, we had to get in touch with demonstration leaders, right? Like, who are these people? Who's organizing these events? We have no clue, right? And the task force members came together and helped us identify who we could talk to, not to stop the demonstrations, but to get them the information that they needed so that they could do what they were doing safely, to get masks in their hands, to have them share warnings and best practices in terms of how to protect yourself, safety protocols with those who showed up at the demonstrations. And we were able to do that both with demonstrators and police departments. And so I just wanna use that as an example of how you can respond merely through not taking people for granted, the resources that you have, but understanding that the folks you know, the stakeholders you work with, have the power of relationships, mm-hmm. and convening those folks gives you an opportunity to effectively address any specific problem.
I was gonna say from a unique perspective, I am not a native Michigander. I will not say where I'm from. But you asked about best practices, and I think, you know, it was mentioned at the top of the meeting, but the Racial Disparities Task Force was an interdisciplinary team, brought a lot of different voices to the table. Everyone's voice was heard, so we listened to one another, and we took that and we synthesized it into singular recommendations. So credit to Tommy and the Lieutenant Governor and the team there. But the interdisciplinary thing, I think, is nothing new. What I really appreciated was the bidirectional communication with the communities and how the information was shared ultimately down to the communities to re-empower them, as you mentioned, but also to listen to their voice and bring that all the way up to the top to make sure that every different voice was heard. I think that was a tremendous strength of the task force that lasted throughout. Even on some of our task force Friday meetings, there were folks who gave praise and there were some who openly disagreed or challenge what we were doing, and that was very helpful. Tommy always handled it with grace, but it allowed us to rethink what we were doing, just allowing that critical opportunity to reconstruct our approach, I think was tremendously impressive as an outsider.
Yeah, I love you lifting that up about being interdisciplinary, because I think the other piece of it is that you saw academe. We had scientists, we had people from the health community. We had folks who, like, how do you even pronounce that word that Dr. O just said? Which was, in many cases, we were all like Googling it at the same time. So not only interdisciplinary, but very purposeful in who is at the table. So to reinforce, I think, what Tommy is saying, as we're looking at issues, is that, so who are we deliberately bringing to this party? do they have a spirit of cooperation? Do they have that skill set? Do they represent the constituencies and the various professions that can indeed inform us? And I think the other piece is there equity in that table? So often as we talk about, we know that parents are essential to create the change for kids and to create the change for society. But are we creating an equitable table for those parent voices to be there? What kind of support do they need? So if we want them at the table, do we provide childcare? Are we providing resources? Are we providing stipends? So moving from a systems level down to how we make it happen locally, those are the other kinds of elements, I think, that are really important for us to build the capacity in our communities to be a real partner with the government to make sure that we are creating a system at various levels that helps keep us safe and well.
Thank you so much. This has been incredibly fruitful and rich. I really like this takeaway of living through equitable principles, right? If we are doing the work, we have to really have those courageous conversations that Robert was talking about. We have to name things, we have to be able to disagree and have those tough conversations. So at this point, I know we are already in our Q&A time, so I've taken about 3 to 4 minutes for our Q&A, and I want to just open it up. We have an MDCR staff who will pass the mic, and please just raise your hand, state your question, and then any of our panelists can take it. And I'm sorry, the lights really challenge me to see if there's any question at all.
Hello, everyone. My name is Janelle Davron, and I'm a 3L at Cooley Law School. I'm also a legislative student assistant for the Michigan Department of Civil Rights, and I just had a quick question. The panel discussed today the importance of diversity, equity, and the need for having trusted messengers, representatives, and healthcare providers and committee leaders at the table when attempting to address the issue of disparity in the healthcare system that became even more evident during the COVID-19 pandemic. Can you please just briefly discuss any legislation or bills that came about in response to some of the issues discussed here today? Thank you.
Good, okay. Yeah, well, real quick, I think one of the more substantive things, and we mentioned it, was using the legislative process to establish the implicit bias requirement for the licensing of health professionals. That was something we proposed to the governor. She signed off on it. And our licensing and regulation, is that what it was?
Laura.
Yeah, licensing and regulation department went through the licensing approval process to get that, make that a requirement for professionals. But I think almost, but probably equally important, maybe even more important, is the $300+ million worth of recommendations that we placed, that the governor signed off on and included in her recommendation for approval to the legislature. And so any day now, we should know how much of that gets approved. But the things that we asked for from a sustainability standpoint was funding to continue to support and expand the services in 22 health neighborhood health centers around the state. Resources to support a continuation and expansion of our mobile health units, expansion of the clinical services made available to those afflicted with sickle cell, $10 million for to continue to build out and maintain our data infrastructure so that we could continue to track racial disparities effectively as associated with health. And we had a huge, you know, $300 million ask related to improving HVAC systems in schools, in public schools and nursery schools, all in an effort to reduce infection rates. So those go through the legislative process. They're going through as we sit here. They may have been approved as we speak. We keep our fingers crossed. It'd be helpful, this is a shameless plug, if you wanna call your state representative or your state senator and say, support the Racial Disparities Task Force recommendations for funding, we would sincerely appreciate it.
So there were things that, as Tommy said, that were direct. There were other decisions that got legislative support and support from the governor's office for the release and how the ARPA funds were done. So one of the things we didn't talk very much about, but we know that there was not only an impact on our physical health, it's our social, emotional, and the mental health. So we know that's had a profound effect, and we don't even know, really. I mean, many of us at some point, including myself, when we can breathe, we'll suddenly feel all of what we've been through. But we know many folks in our community need more mental health services. It's wonderful to be able to say that we now have seen an increase in community mental health agencies. We've seen an increase in funding to go to schools to bring in community health and behavioral health services and support. That can only continue, though, as our folks like you are doing exactly what Tommy is saying, is that we engage our legislators to continue to make sure those funds are available to address those kinds of issues. But we've seen a great deal to increase education, mental health services that are really also all tied to housing and transportation. All of those are part of the social determinants of health that also drive health and well-being.
I just wanted to quickly add that one of the things also that's a part of the task force recommendations and a part of the budget asked right now is the equity impact assessment process. And it was connected to the governor's declaration of racism as a public health crisis as a tangible way for us to really train our employees, our staff on biases, discrimination, et cetera, and for them to make some explicit considerations when they're developing new programs or new policies, you know, allocating resources on what the impact or potentially adverse impacts could be on our populations of color, our other marginalized populations. And it's something that we piloted within MDHHS, but with the goal, you know, the governor had the goal of replicating across state government. So we're in the process of doing that now, and really we look that will be something that can be modeled and used in all of our decisions. We need to, you know, make sure we're making informed decisions. But I wanted to make a point of, as a best practice, at least in my experience, leadership and our ability to add and sustain those services through this legislative process is a best practice. You know, for us to actually lift it up and say, we've built this infrastructure and this work, let's continue to support this work. So I do, you know, really say that leadership, it was key in that happening in this case.
Just one other point, I think we would be remiss. Not only did we have government involved with us, philanthropy was at the table. And that's a really important dynamic, particularly for community-based organizations, that we had many step up to partner to make sure that resources were being available and folks got what they could need.
So I'll just take one more question. Thank you so much for the time. We have time for one question, and we'll have just a couple of you answer, perhaps, so that we can get you out of here on time. Anyone else?
Hi, my name is Jennifer. I'm here with the Dear Age and Youth Novi Club at the Novi High School. And I have a couple questions. So I thought it was a very insightful discussion on the panel today, so thank you. And the question I had was, next time an emergency happens, which is pretty likely, what new advice do you have for minorities who might be affected, having learned what you know from the COVID situation, and what measures can be taken to ensure that we lessen that impact?
That's a beautiful question. Thank you so much. What a way to close it. Thank you. Who would like to take that?
I can start. I don't know. Be able to give the right answer, but you know, Certainly, we do anticipate to be another public health threat or emergency. And the first thing to remember is there's not going to be a one-size-fits-all. Different individuals may have different responses or may be receptive to different responses. So I would think that the first and foremost for an individual to go to their trusted community leaders. You know, we have worked very hard with the Disparity Task Force to already make those connections with individuals in the community who will receive the correct information, as Jametta mentioned earlier, to try to avoid that misinformation and disinformation that's out there. And we can share with them on a quick basis. These might be religious leaders in the community, barbershops, just individuals who have a lot of influence within their own areas. And so to go to them, we've also tried to make sure that messaging at the state level, as well as at the federal level, is translated in many different ways for individuals. So while there might be some hesitancy from state and government officials, we're always welcoming feedback, we're trying to craft our messaging so that it can reach in individuals. And so to continue to trust your individuals, and specifically with public health, the messaging that comes out of MDHHS and the messaging that comes out of the CDC. And then lastly, I do think it's actually safe to be a little bit of a skeptic. I think that's important. It strives us to do better within our fields, but to question everything and not to take everything just at face value, but certainly to ask why. You know, why are you giving me this advice? So those are the three things that I would that I would take, or that I would tell my grandfather or grandmother.
And I would suggest, first and foremost, that you organize at the local level. You have a lot of power. Your voice is important. You and your classmates, your friends, family, and neighbors, if you pull them together to focus on a problem and take your suggestions to your local health officials or state officials, it does have meaning. And so change starts at the individual level. Yes. And so it's up to us individually to take the initiative to drive the change that we want to see. Or is that be the change we want to see?
Well, thank you, honorable leaders, for being here. Hopefully you saw this session fruitful, and if you have more questions, there are a couple of reports that the Racial Disparities Task Force put out as well. And I don't want to speak for people, but they're always very open to hearing from you and receiving any questions or, you know, follow-ups. At this point, I will transition to Alfredo.
Thank you, Yesenia. I will have to say that, you know, as someone who had the opportunity to collaborate with the five folks you see here, tremendous amount of knowledge, expertise, being a part of the meetings and seeing everybody engage in so much important work, as we didn't know what COVID was and any of those things. I believe we're fortunate to have people like this doing important work in our state. So thank you, Yesenia, Brenda, Tommy, Jametta, and Robert for really being committed to this work and for the expertise that you bring into our state and the people that you're assigned to serve. And you do an amazing job. So let's give him a round of applause, please. So we're gonna go now to, if you choose to stay with us, which I hope you do, we're gonna go to the large room again. We have a 15-minute break. We'll start at 3:00. We have two great keynote speakers. We're done officially at 4, but if you choose to stay back with us after 4, we have a time for drinks and relaxation and conversation, so you're welcome to stay. Take your 15 minutes, and we'll see you in the large room at 3. Thank you.